Good evening. My name is Dr. Nina Ahmad, and I will be your moderator for this series on COVID-19 by the American Academy of Family Physicians. We will be hosting this series on Friday nights at 7 p.m. Central Standard Time. Each week, we will have a brief status update and a guest speaker. You can ask questions of our speakers before and after each session through the message exchange board. You can also ask questions through the chat feature. Speakers will try their best to answer as many questions as they can, and some questions may be answered on future sessions. These sessions will be recorded live, so you can always refer back to them. And feel free to comment so we can adjust sessions based on your feedback. This session is approved for 1 AAFP prescribed credits. It's an enduring credit, so you can always refer back to it. It's also approved for 2 T2P or translation to practice credits. And the speakers today have nothing to disclose. Here are today's learning objectives. First, we'll go over a quick situation summary and then a background information. Then we'll have our guest speaker, Dr. Naomi Clancy, speak. We'll have question and answer and T2P reflection. Here's a graph as of today of the different countries of the total confirmed COVID-19 cases. It shows the projection, a snapshot of what's going on. And you can see in red, the United States, in blue, Italy, and in green, China. Here you can see the cases and deaths by state. So you can see the state distribution as of yesterday. And you can see the total number of cases at more than 1.3 million and total number of deaths at 83,947. So there's been a lot of information coming out about children in the media and also in papers. And first, we were going to go over the lessons from COVID-19 in children, an article that came out earlier in the month. And from that, they stated that children can be infected with SARS-CoV-2 and that less severe disease and lower case fatality than adults have been found for children, which is similar to SARS-CoV-1 and MERS. Epidemiological evidence across countries consistently reveal this information. And in the United States, they found 22% of the population are children, but only 1.7% of SARS-CoV-2 infections identified to date have been in children, which is also consistent with estimates in China. The study tries to talk about why that possibly could be, and they cite the children might be less likely tested due to symptomology and also the limited testing capabilities that are available. So in the news and in recent articles, we've heard about hyperinflammatory shock in children during the COVID-19 pandemic. And where this started was a correspondence published on May 6th, which talked about a situation where it was similar to atypical Kawasaki's disease. The South Thames Retrieval Service in London, UK, provides intensive care support and retrieval to 2 million children in Southeast England. And during 10 days in mid-April 2020, they identified 8 children who had a hyperinflammatory shock. And typically during that time frame, they would have 1 to 2 per week. They issued a national alert based on this cluster. And of these 8 children, they found all were fit and well. 75% were Afro-Caribbean descent. 63% were boys. 88% were well above the 75th percentile for weight, and 50% had known exposure to a family member. What they found in these children were that they had unrelenting fever, variable rash, conjunctivitis, peripheral edema, generalized extremity pain with gastrointestinal symptoms, warm vasoplegic shock, refractory volume resuscitation, and there was no significant respiratory involvement, though 7 eventually needed a mechanical ventilation. There was development of small pleural, pericardial, and acidic effusions. All children ended up testing negative for SARS-CoV-2 on bronchoalveolar lavage or nasopharyngeal aspirates. no pathological organism was identified in the children except for adenovirus and enterovirus, which was isolated in one child. EKGs, baseline EKGs were nonspecific. And echocardiographic findings showed echobright coronary vessels, and one patient ended up progressing to giant coronary aneurysm within a week of discharge from the ICU. So I tried to put together this chart showing the microbiology of the SARS-CoV-2, where they found a positive result and where they noted exposure or no exposure. You can see of those who had a SARS-CoV-2 positive result on microbiology, one had a known exposure and the other one did not have a known exposure. The other ones had no SARS-CoV-2 noted on testing. So the theory, what's going on? So they theorize there's a hyperinflammatory syndrome with multi-organ involvement similar to Kawasaki's disease shock syndrome after asymptomatic infection with SARS-CoV-2. 1 week after the initial submission of this correspondence, they identified 20 children total of similar presentations. And the first 10, including the 8 that were mentioned here, presented with positive antibody testing. Since then, they've also identified a paper that got published a few days ago in The Lancet for Italy, and multiple states are now reporting about a similar syndrome, and the CDC has put out a health advisory as of yesterday. The other study we're going to talk about is early self-proning while awake. Multiple speakers have talked about proning and how it's been helpful for these patients. Here we have an observational cohort study that was recently published. It was a convenience sample in one emergency room in New York City during March 1st to April 1st. You can see the inclusion criteria were adults, a certain criteria for hypoxia. People had to be able to prone themselves, and they had to have a positive test result for SARS-CoV-2. The exclusion criteria were DNR, DNI, code status, cardiac arrest, receiving non-invasive ventilation, or those who were intubated in the pre-hospital setting, and you'll see why in a little bit. And median age for these patients were 59, 60% were male, and 80% were tachypneic. So you can see they looked at 50 patients during this time frame that met inclusion criteria. 28 showed up with no oxygen and the rest arrived with oxygen. The median oxygen saturation was 75% for those who arrived with no oxygen, and with those who arrived with oxygen, the median oxygen saturation was 82%. So at triage, oxygen saturation was 80%. They gave supplemental oxygen, and the median rose to 84%. After 5 minutes of proning, the median oxygen saturation rose to 94%, which was statistically significant pre and post medians. Then they looked at how many were intubated after a certain time frame after proning, and they found after 30 minutes of proning, 4 were intubated. 30 to 60 minutes of proning, 3 were intubated. Greater than 60 minutes to 24 hours, 6 were intubated. 24 to 48 hours, 3 were intubated. And over 72 hours of proning, 2 were intubated, for a total of 18 people who were intubated after the procedure. So they do admit to limitations in the study, being that it was in one location. They didn't control for factors. But it was more information about how proning might actually help. And lastly, I'll leave you with this review article focused predominantly on resource-limited settings. They talk about key findings and key tips for these types of settings. They reiterate a lot of things that we've talked about during these series, such as supplemental oxygen being essential for severe disease, that hospitals dealing with COVID-19 really need to assure the availability of oxygen, that oxygen delivery can be increased with non-rebreathing masks and proning. Protection of healthcare workers is obviously crucial. CPAP and BiPAP provides PEEP, but they need further evaluation to find out more about its role. Hypoxemia alone within limits should not trigger intubation. And patients with fatigue and at risk for exhaustion, we should consider invasive ventilation. Now I'd like to introduce Dr. Naomi Clancy. She's Associate Medical Director of Family Medicine in the rural community of Morenci, Arizona. She's a Clinical Assistant Professor in the Department of Family, Community, and Preventative Medicine at the University of Arizona College of Medicine, Phoenix. And she's the Chair of the American Academy of Family Physicians Rural Health Member Interest Group. Dr. Clancy, her husband, and their three children enjoy gardening, hiking, camping, and raising too many chickens. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I've been asked today to talk about my rural community's response to the COVID crisis. And this is a picture of my clinic, Gila Health Resources in Morenci, Arizona. So yes, the sky really is this blue most of the time. We are in southeastern Arizona. We're a town of about 1,400 in a county of about 8,500. And we're on the side of the largest copper gold mine in North America. This is a bit of the tailings pile right here that you can see behind the clinic. The clinic is located in the old Morenci Hospital. We don't have a hospital in our county anymore. Our nearest hospital is an hour away by ground, and our nearest tertiary care facility is 3 hours by ground or 45 minutes by air. In our facility, we have family medicine, urgent care, which functions as a mini ER. We see major trauma. We carry tenecteplase and rattlesnake antivenin and scorpion antivenin. We're actually a hot spot for the bark scorpion, which is the scorpion who in venomation gives you the seizures and nystagmus and frothing at the mouth that you remember from your board exams. We have occupational medicine, physical therapy, a moderate complexity laboratory, and x-ray. And we also have a branch of a pharmacy from the next county over, which is a different organization. So when we look at Arizona COVID cases as of Wednesday, these have changed somewhat since I put these slides together. This is the county with Phoenix in it. This is the county with Tucson. And this is us. So certainly our population plays into some of that. But when you look at the COVID cases per capita, this is the county with Phoenix, and this is the county with Tucson, and our per capita cases are still quite low as compared to the rest of Arizona. And we certainly don't expect this to continue. We are grateful for it. We've been very fortunate in that regard. But ever since we completed our COVID preparations several weeks ago, we've basically just been waiting for the hammer to drop, and it hasn't dropped yet. So our county and our organization has had some advantages in terms of our COVID response. And the first of which is that we had a pre-existing disaster plan that included infectious disease and regular training. So although we're a small community, because of the mine, our community is actually quite international. The mine owns other mines across the world. And so we have people coming and going regularly from Peru and the Philippines and Senegal and Congo and Japan. And because of this, we've known that we're at greater risk for infectious diseases from other places in the world. We've actually had cases of chikungunya and Zika in our community. And when the Ebola crisis hit several years ago, the mine actually owned a mine in Congo at the time. And so we were quite worried that Ebola was going to make its way into our community. So we have an outdoor triage tent that can be heated and cooled. We had at that point identified an isolation unit, which, not to be morbid, is actually our old hospital morgue, because it's the one place that's not getting used in our facility and just tells you about our space limitations in a rural setting. And we started doing regular training at that point for all clinical staff in donning and doffing of full PPE. And just after the Ebola crisis, we continued that on a yearly basis along with our employee health training. Another advantage was that we just unexpectedly had space to expand. We were weeks away from an entire building massive remodel when COVID hit. And that remodel is probably not going to happen anymore. But two city departments that were in our building had moved out, and our billing department was getting ready to move into their space and had already started packing. And you'll see as we move on in the slides, we were able to move our billing department over the course of a weekend into a different part of the building and turn that into a respiratory isolation unit, which has been wonderful. when you're in a rural location, there's not very many of you, but that does make it easier to communicate. And so we had easy, early and consistent communication with public health, the mine, the school district, the county, other stakeholders. And we saw very, very early response in our community by employers to reduce their employees' risk. Long before the official recommendations came out, our employers were doing social distancing practices at home, masks at work, telework, temperature checks, hand sanitizing, and that reduced our community's exposure. And in our community, the mine owns the public facilities. They own the fitness center, the library, the community club, movies, and they closed those 3 weeks, before Arizona closed down. And so again, reducing that public exposure. But the biggest advantage, I have to say, has been in regards to PPE. And when I saw the title of this with a resource limited environment, you know, I felt bad because we are not resource limited when it comes to PPE. Early in the process, we did an inventory of our PPE. We started preserving our PPE. And then when the FDA put in emergency use authorization early in the COVID crisis for healthcare facilities to use NIOSH certified PPE, that's the National Institute of Occupational Safety and Health, there's NIOSH certified masks that are similar to the N95 masks. We spoke with the mine to find out if we could use their equipment if necessary, and they gave us open rein to do that. Now, fortunately, we haven't had to because we've been able to preserve our PPE. We had a mask drive in our community that provided cloth masks for our facility so we can use our surgical masks and N95s only for patient encounters. But just knowing that it's there has been so reassuring. Another advantage that you wouldn't think of is that we're on a year-round school system, and our spring break was 2 weeks from March 9th to 20th, which was late enough that everybody's spring break travel had been canceled, and so everybody stayed home, but long enough that by the time kids were getting set to come back to school, it was clear that the school district needed to close down. So our school district didn't have to go through what other districts did in terms of deciding, okay, when do we close? When do we send people home? And at least for those 2 weeks, people already had childcare arranged because they knew they were going to be on spring break anyhow. And then there's just been an incredible community response. When I'm doing my telemedicine visits with patients and talking to them, okay, how you doing with all this self-isolation? They really are self-isolating, especially our older patients, especially our patients with underlying medical conditions, immunosuppression. We've had food and water deliveries by the fire department to anybody who needs them. The mask drive, like I talked about, it's just been a whole community response. And I also have to be grateful for my organization's response. I work with a whole bunch of people who, when I come in and say, okay, this is how we're answering the phone this morning, everybody's just rolling with it and making things happen. So I work with an incredible group of people. So our phase one of the COVID response, this is in late February. We reviewed our disaster plan, discussed isolation of people under investigation, and rapidly realized that our one isolation unit was not going to be enough. So we figured out what we needed to do there. I did an inventory of PPE. We pulled our outdoor pop-up tent out of storage where it hadn't been opened in quite a long time and started communicating with public health, EMS, mine, and the school district. And then our phase two has been just changing and changing and changing. So this slide here is about 2 weeks, and these changes were happening either day by day or sometimes hour by hour. So we started out with the front desk screening for PUIs, and they were asking the questions, cough, fever, shortness of breath, and any travel to an affected country. Symptomatic patients were masked. We got some refusals for masks, and then we had to develop a company policy of what we were going to do with people who refused masks. We started sending infoblasts to patients, and another of our advantages is we had just started using a tablet-based check-in system that had the ability to send out blasts over email or text a month before COVID hit. We started doing increased cleaning of high-touch areas, and that meant increasing our housekeeping hours, and I'm very grateful to our housekeeping staff for doing all that. Increasing hand sanitizer availability and limiting mask availability. We normally keep hand sanitizer and masks outside family medicine and urgent care for sick people, and our masks were disappearing by the handfuls, so we had to take those away and only give them out to symptomatic people. We discovered an alcohol-based sanitizer supply shortage because it turns out, since we do drug and alcohol testing, that a couple of years ago, we stopped using alcohol-based hand sanitizer so we wouldn't accidentally get a false positive on our alcohol testing. So we didn't have any in the facility. And by then, by the time we discovered that, there was none to be had. So we very rapidly changed to bleach and soap and water. Then, as COVID heated up, we, on public health recommendations, separated the building into a sick and a well section and started triaging all respiratory illnesses to urgent care. PUIs were seen in full PPE. They were brought in a separate door to the back rooms of urgent care. And we don't have a negative pressure unit, but we have a portable air filter. And so we were moving that into PUIs rooms. We stopped using that check-in system that we had just started using unless the patient had their own device. And then as things heated up even more, we, over the course of 48 hours, converted the billing department to an urgent care isolation unit. And I have to thank our paramedics and our urgent care nursing director and her family for moving all that stuff in and out. In the process, we had to move the employee break room, which was in that same area, into an old conference room. And we started doing more aggressive preservation of PPE. So reusing masks and re-sterilizing things as per the CDC guidelines. Like I said, we coordinated with the mine on NIOSH certified masks, and we haven't had to use their particular ones, although we have purchased some full face units, which I'll get to. We separated the family medicine waiting room into sick and well, which are sick with non-respiratory illnesses, and we did a trial of telemedicine visits. None of us in family medicine had ever done a telemedicine visit before, although we had had a telepsychiatrist for the last year, and so we had a platform and we were a bit familiar with that. Then our urgent care nursing staff were getting overwhelmed with COVID-related calls to the point that they weren't able to help with patient care. And so we very rapidly created a 24-hour COVID hotline that was staffed by doctors and PAs. And we worked with the mine so the patients didn't need a work note to stay home, which really reduced our volume because a lot of the reason people were coming in was for work notes. And once we were able to tell them on our COVID hotline, you don't need a note. If your HR says they want a note, they can call us, but based on what I can assess over the phone, it sounds like you're safe to stay home. People were staying home. We moved most industrial injuries evaluations from urgent care to OCMED to further reduce patient exposure, and we established a no visitor policy for the building, as most facilities have. And then 6 days after our first trial of a telemedicine visit, we went to near 100% telemedicine visits. We started doing contingency planning for providers and staff to work from home. We didn't end up having staff work from home, but we did start rotating family medicine providers working from home to reduce exposure, with the idea that if our urgent care providers had to self-isolate, then our family medicine providers would be able to cover. We do a lot of injections because we do allergy shots, and so we started having our injection patients call from the parking lot, and they're brought in the back door to a designated room, or we're doing shots in cars if patients prefer. And patients were instructed in self-injection in case we had to close down completely. Then we worked with the pharmacy to help them distance their clientele, because they're a very small space with a lot of people crowded in there. And so that took some work. We looked at medication delivery for isolated patients. The fire department started delivering food and water, and we canceled all in-person staff meetings. And then we had our first COVID case, which was travel related. So at that point, we went to all people in the building being masked. We purchased full face respirators from full face masks from the mine, which have individualized replaceable cartridges. We stopped giving nebulization therapies, using only MDIs in urgent care. And we started reviewing how are we going to reduce risk for during intubation, and should we be intubating at all? And of course, that's a question that's being asked all over the country still. Our urgent care started doing a no-touch evaluation at the car side. So this is basically in-person telemedicine. So the patient comes into the parking lot, parks, calls urgent care, and the nurse comes out, does vitals, and assesses them. Then the in full PPE, and the provider, either doctor or PA, comes out in full PPE and does a no-touch evaluation. If they determine the patient by that and their vitals to be stable, then they get tested by lab tech in full PPE in their car and discharged to home. If they're not stable, then they're transferred to the respiratory isolation unit. So up until this point, we have had very, very limited testing availability. I think during the entire month of March, I think we had 22 tests in the whole county. So finally, at this point, we started having expanded testing availability for our PCR. And we were able to purchase some IgM, IgG tests. But within days of purchasing, before we could even start using them, the FDA revised its list of which tests could be used by moderate complexity laboratories, and our test is not on there. So we have 200 IgM, IgG tests sitting in our lab that we can't yet use. And at this point, our reference lab didn't have an IgG test, so we couldn't test it, which was sad. But the community cloth mask drive was started and has been wildly successful. I'll show you some pictures there. And then we ran into the pause. So just like many, many people's offices, we've had significant decrease in both family medicine and urgent care volume. We've been able to keep up some most of our family medicine volume with telemedicine visits, although it's been a little lower than usual. And I think a lot of that is because we are just seeing a decrease in general infections in the community. So all of this social distancing, hand washing, face mask wearing, it's working. The last 2 years, our influenza season has lasted through June in this community. We saw influenza in March. We see none now. People are not getting gastroenteritis. They're not getting respiratory illnesses. So now that we actually have expanded testing capability, we don't have people to test. So we're doing about 4 tests a day, and we're testing people that are symptomatic for the entire long list of symptoms based on the CDC revisions. So then we finally got IgG testing available from our reference laboratory and rolled that out to the community a couple of weeks ago. And we started preparing for a second surge because we know it's going to come. We're facing here in family medicine what many places with low COVID numbers are facing of how do we return to safely doing face-to-face visits. So right now, we actually a week ago returned to in-person well visits for pediatrics and healthy adults 60 and under without underlying medical conditions. And then we're basically just waiting to see how we can further expand, when we should further expand to adults under 60 with chronic medical conditions and then adults over 60. So right now for our in-person visits, we are doing social distancing. Patient calls from the parking lot. When it's their turn, an MA comes out and takes them directly into the waiting room. The MA is wearing face mask and gloves. If they need laboratories, laboratory actually comes into the exam room as opposed to having them go through the building. So here's some pictures. And this here, used to be our provider parking and is now our COVID parking. So a patient pulls up here and calls urgent care. The nurse comes out and evaluates them. That's our outdoor tent, and this is the entry to urgent care, which is seen further right here. And this used to be billing and is now our respiratory isolation unit. So if someone comes up to the door, they're greeted by someone in at least partial PPE, and then triaged if necessary over to this door, and staff comes around and greets them in full PPE. This is some of our urgent care staff socially distancing there. And this is our new respiratory isolation unit. So as I said, we were in the old hospital. So these were actually hospital rooms. They really didn't need much revision at all. We had to pull out some carpet and rapidly put in linoleum. From the Ebola epidemic, we had purchased Crocs for many, many people. And so all of the urgent care staff have their own individualized named Crocs that they wear when they go into the isolation unit. And we're separating out our staff into two groups. So normally we have a doctor and a PA, two nurses, and we used to staff with one tech. We're now staffing with two techs. So half of that, one doctor or PA, one nurse, and one tech, stay in the respiratory isolation unit during the day, and the other half see the non-sick patients so that we can reduce exposure. This is some of my family medicine staff socially distancing and our extremely high-tech signs telling people where to call. And this is me doing telemedicine visits. And as you can see, I do not have a high-tech setup. I have a cell phone in a stand, which I think was $6 at Walmart, and my laptop and this computers on wheels is what we have normally, our cows. I have been grateful to this because I've been able to stand for my telemedicine visits as opposed to sitting all day because I'm used to moving around more. And you remember all those studies that say that if you sit more than 3 hours a day, you have increased mortality. This is our occupational medicine PA who has headed up the mask drive in conjunction with the public health department and two of her amazing helpers. And they have coordinated making and distributing almost as many masks as we have people in the county since the 9th of April. So 8,178 as of Wednesday, and they are still making them and they're still distributing them. So I was asked to talk about telemedicine because this is brand new for me. This is brand new for a lot of people. We want to make sure that we're getting paid for it properly. In my family medicine office, three FPs and one NP, as I said, we had 6 days from first trial to near 100%. We're using this Microsoft Teams 365. This actually came with our Microsoft Office package. So if you look at your Office package, you may have something similar. It gives us the ability to send the patient a HIPAA-compliant link that brings them into a HIPAA-compliant video visit. And if they aren't able to access that, then we very rapidly move on to our backups. We were using DocCME regularly. And if that wasn't working, then moving over to FaceTime. I don't have an iPhone, so I had to borrow my MA's iPhone for FaceTime, but we really did rely on FaceTime for quite a lot during the first few weeks. Now, Doximity Dialer, which you may have used, has brought its, it was only for Apple before, it's now brought Android out of beta, so I can use that for my patients. So I'm actually going to that to my second backup. That enables you to call the patient for an audio or a video visit from your cell phone, and it identifies the call as coming from your office, so you're not using your personal cell phone number, and it's not coming through as restricted, which means the patient is more likely to answer it. And then we very rapidly moved to telephone visits, and as we'll discuss in a minute, we now have payment parity for telephone visits, which makes it a lot easier. So coding a video visit, oh, and just to talk about platforms briefly, these are all free platforms, and that's just what we've elected to use in my office. But the AAFP has a long list on their telemedicine site under the COVID tab of other platforms that can be used, and they're not evaluating them, they're just letting people know. I also would recommend the telemedicine member interest group because there's a lot of people with lots more experience in telemedicine than I have that can give you recommendations on certain platforms. So coding video visits, you're using your same E&M codes as usual. You're documenting on the top of the note that it's a telemedicine visit, and you're not forgetting to document that you got consent for that visit. So telemedicine pre-CARES Act was very different. I'm only going to talk about the CARES Act changes. So the Coronavirus Aid, Economic Relief and Security Act that was passed in March, I'm lumping things together a little bit here because some of these changes were made later, but they all go under the CARES Act. So we now have payment parity for telemedicine and telephonic visits as compared to face-to-face visits. But to receive payment parity, you're not using the old telemedicine code, the place of service 02. You're using your place of service code you normally use, like 11 for an outpatient office, with a modifier 95 to indicate telehealth. Otherwise, you will not get payment parity. Time-based billing is now allowed. It wasn't before. So that's the typical CMS time for greater than 50% of this visit was in care coordination and counseling. Audio-only visits are now covered under the CPT codes 99441 through 99443, and they're going to be paid as of March 1st, as of May 1st, retroactive to March 1st. They're paid equally with a 99212, 99213, or 99214, and you do need to record the amount of time that you've spent in your note. You can now see new patients over video or audio visits. You can use non-HIPAA-compliant platforms, FaceTime, Skype, and Duo, etc. Rural health clinics and FQHCs can now serve as the distance site for telehealth visits under this code G0071, which means that they don't have to see the patients face-to-face. They can provide the rural health clinic and FQHC practitioners can now call patients over a video or telephone visit with the patient in their home. And they're getting payment parity as well. And physicians can reduce or waive cost sharing for COVID-19 related telehealth visits, virtual check-ins, e-visits, remote care management, and remote patient monitoring if you use the CS monitor. Now you say, why would I want to do that? Because I've already got reduced revenue because of my reduced volume. Why would I want to waive the cost sharing, the copay? We actually are doing that in our office for those COVID hotline calls, because in my community, we haven't previously charged for telephone visits. And so this is a way for us to make a small amount of revenue, but the patient doesn't see the copay portion of that. So very briefly on telephone billing, there are some rules. It's provided to a patient, a parent, or a guardian, and doesn't originate from a related E&M service within the previous 7 days, doesn't lead to an E&M service or procedure within the next 24 hours or soonest available appointment. You can break it down by 5 to 10 minutes of medical discussion, 11 to 20, and 21 to 30. And you'll see that the language is medical discussion. So that does not include the amount of time that it took for your MA to get the patient on the telephone visit. It doesn't include you reviewing records before the visit or after visit. That's the actual amount of time you spent on the phone with the patient. And we do have payment parity for that. Virtual check-in, I want to touch on briefly. This was there before we got payment parity for telephone visits. And so most people aren't going to be using this anymore, but we don't know if the telephone coverage is going to stay. So I just want to briefly go over it. 5 to 10 minutes, video or telephone, same rules, doesn't originate from a related E&M service within the previous 7 days or lead to an E&M service and procedure within the next 24 hours. That's a HCPCS G2012. Chronic care management, I want to touch on briefly because this has been really vital for checking on our elderly sick patients during the COVID crisis. So we've been doing chronic care management for about 3 years, but with isolation, I'm finding more and more patients on telemedicine visits that are extremely isolated, no family, very lonely, and we're offering them chronic care management not only so we can check on them and make sure they're not ignoring conditions that they should be going to the ER for, but also to increase their social contact, and they are happily accepting. There are some rules to chronic care management that are listed here for you that'll be in the video, recorded afterwards. Coordination of care and transfers. You know, we really haven't had any trouble in our region with transfer capacity, but what we have learned is we need to talk with our accepting facility as to whether they want us to do the test, the COVID test, or if they are going to do the COVID test, because that's created some hiccups. And in our community, we only have 5 EMS units. We only staff 2 of them usually. And we previously weren't able to send one of our 2 units out for 6 hours round trip to transfer by ground to a tertiary care facility. So actually before COVID in January, we had expanded that to an extra unit, staffing an extra unit just to accommodate for increased ground-based transfers. So we've been able to use that for more stable patients that do need that tertiary care facility. And then for surge planning, everything I talked about is surge planning, but specifically the auto vents have been very reassuring for us. We haven't had to use them so far, but an auto vent is this itty bitty teeny tiny ventilator unit that has 3 settings. And with our 3-bed isolation unit and our tent, if we were unable to transfer, we can stabilize 4 patients on auto vents before we can get them somewhere else that they need to be. So I want to leave you with an image from a t-shirt that I got recently that I just love. We can do it. We're family physicians. We're prepared for this. We roll with the punches. It's been lovely talking to you tonight.
Thank you so much for that. I think you had a lot of interesting things to say that were very new and different than what we've heard in other presentations. While I look to the questions in the feed, I just want to remind our members to reflect on what you might have learned here as part of the T2P reflection and consider how you might change your practice in the future, given what you've heard. So for our first question, Rick Mediter from Facebook asks, does smaller and therefore better communication also enhance your ability to spread true knowledge of COVID to the community?
Well, when you only have a limited number of doctors in the community, then if you're all on board, then that's the information you're going to be spreading. So I would say yes. I definitely have had patients getting information from Facebook, which is wildly out there, and I've been able to tamper some of that down. We are really benefited also in our community that our previous medical director, who retired several years ago, is still the medical director for public health. So we're all tied in. So.
And then our next question is from Steven Christensen from YouTube, who asks, how efficacious is the portable air filter unit? More details on this device, please.
Ooh, I may have to get back with you on that. This was something that we've had for quite a few years because we know we don't have a negative pressure unit. Now, with this big remodel that we were about to start, we were actually going to get two negative pressure units, and it remains to be seen if we'll ever get that remodel now with the decreased revenue and all that. But it is essentially a heavy duty filtration unit that is supposed to act a little bit like a negative pressure unit, or negative, create some kind of sucking of the bugs towards it and being filtered. But I can get you more details on that if you like.
That's great. And then her answer will be on the member exchange message board, so it can always be referred back to later in the week. And then there's a comment from Kim Yu from Facebook. Awesome that you have PPE and year-round school. In the Larry Green Center survey this week, over 50% primary care continue to lack access to testing or PPE. Would be great to know the breakdown of access to PPE and testing in rural versus non-rural areas. So I think that's a comment, unless you know the answer to that.
No, it sounds like a comment to me, but we have just been so fortunate. We actually had a pretty good quantity of PPE. Our public health department also had some stockpiles that we haven't had to tap into, but those are there. And then I would encourage folks in your communities to reach out to other organizations, you know, your larger employees, if they have some kind of PPE, they've got some kind of national organization overseeing that PPE, like NIOSH, and you can probably find something similar.
And then our next question is, it seems like you possibly answered the question during the talk. Laura Hebler from Facebook asks or says, we are starting next week to see more patients, 50 schedules, remote check-in, empty waiting times, the rest virtually. We anticipate the lab will be the bottleneck, but it's a work in progress, and you're about to talk about it.
Oh, good. So...
Do you have anything else to add?
So we do, we have lab go into the rooms. We haven't been 100% virtual. And so for our patients that are coming in, they're generally sicker with non-respiratory type stuff and are generally needing labs. So lab is in full PPE and comes into the room so that the patient isn't going through the facility, people piling up outside of lab, that kind of thing.
And we have a number of comments actually talking about concern of reopening and a number of issues that will possibly arise from that. Mm-hmm. Steven Christensen from YouTube says, I practice in Idaho. I feel your pain. And so he also comments about the concern. Emily Peterson from YouTube says, is there any guidance regarding completion of school physicals or sport physical forms via telemedicine?
I am not aware of any guidance on that. For our well child checks, those have been some of the few things that we've been seeing face to face. We do the well child check interview virtually, and then we have the parent come in later in the day just as a pop in, and we work them in. They call from the back parking lot. We scoot them in that same door as the injections, and we get heights, weights, immunizations, and I do a quick exam, because especially for the young ones, I can't do a proper exam over telemedicine. I would say the same thing for a sports physical, because your cardiac exam is one of the most important portions of that. So I would probably do exactly that same thing. It hasn't come up, although now that you mention it, it probably will. but I would do the interview over telehealth and then either assign them a time or tell them just to pop in, call from the parking lot when they get there, slip them in a back door and do a quick cardiac exam while everybody is masked, patient and yourself. And that will limit their time in the building, but also give you the opportunity to do that proper cardiac exam.
I think that's really helpful. And then Robert Smith from Facebook says, in addition to any available FQHC rural health funding, were you able to apply the PPP Paycheck Protection Program loans funding, economic injury disaster loan or grant? We hear that some practices are using crowdfunding like GoFundMe to raise money to pay staff and or pay for patients that have lost their health insurance due to unemployment. Have you considered that? Why or why not?
So we did start applying for the Paycheck Protection Program loan. And I am not entirely sure what the issue was, but we got fairly well through the process and then hit something where we did not qualify for it according to our CEO. And so we weren't able to complete that first round. Now with the second round of funding, I know that we have applied for that, but we have not yet received anything.
And then Stephen Christensen from YouTube says, thank you. Our situation has been frighteningly similar to yours. I guess there's only so many ways you can reinvent the wheel.
I did worry that this would simply be old news to everybody, because this is what we've been doing for the last 2 months, all of us, right?
But I do think you do have a unique perspective, and you've mentioned a couple of things that haven't actually been out there in the general population or in some of the sessions that we've heard from. So it has been helpful to hear you talk about this. And then Stephen, a follow-up to Stephen Christensen's YouTube comment, I would like more details such as make and model number of the filtration unit. Thanks.
Oh, no problem. I will get that for you.
And Rick Metterer from Facebook says, given your unique perspective with the coordination with the mine company, do you have advice on how to work with business to get their full cooperation to combat this disease going forward?
I presume that that may be a business that is not wanting to do the social distancing and masking and hand washing. I'm in a fortunate position because our public health department recommendations have been uniquely followed. I can't say that all of our community members are wearing the masks that we have distributed to them, but a decent portion of them are. The community here, you know, with the mine being our major employer, because our public health medical director was our previous clinic director, the mine has a relationship with him already, and they have all, everybody's really been in excellent communication. So I guess what I would do is I would acknowledge the financial cost that this has all taken, because everybody's taking a hit, and acknowledge at the same time that if they get a COVID outbreak in their facility, they're going to have to shut down completely. And so we want to not only protect their employees, but we want to protect their investment, which is their employees. And so what can we do to keep their investment, their employees, from getting COVID and not having to either go out for 2 weeks or potentially shut down their entire operation?
And then Bill Ang from Facebook asks, do you have any ethnic minority patients, African American, Hispanic, Native American?
Yes. I'm in southeastern Arizona, so we have a very large Hispanic population. I have quite a few Spanish-speaking patients. We have some African American, but we actually have more African patients because of our international community. And so we have patients from Congo, Ghana is a big mining country. And so we have folks coming over from there. We have the international folks that I mentioned before with Peru and the Philippines and Senegal, some folks from Japan. So yeah, we're pretty international.
And then the next two are actually comments about school physicals. Stephen Christensen, so they're follow-ups. In regard to sports physicals, there are smartphone apps that can do EKGs, which might suffice for the low-risk population. And Christy England states that North Dakota is allowing just a screening questionnaire to update sports physicals for patients who had a sports physical last year. If any questions are answered positively, then they need to be seen. So I just wanted to let the members know what was going on in the chat. So Lourdes Vizcarra Wurzel from Facebook asks, is anyone collecting data regarding medical practices closing or going to be going out of business? And you might not know that answer.
I don't know the answer to that.
Do you know of any? I don't know any information off the top of my head that might be being collected, but we can see. And then if we find out anything, put it on the member exchange board.
That sounds good.
And then Kim Yu asks, on the map, you showed a large area north of you that seemed to be heavily affected by COVID. How are you or the public health going to manage potential spread once lockdown lifts? Will there be contact tracing and hoteling?
So that's the Navajo Nation, which you have probably heard on the news, has one of the highest incidences in the country and possibly the world at this point. Medicine Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, there we go, just sent in a unit into the Navajo Reservation because it is so very bad. In New Mexico, the mayor of Gallup asked the governor of New Mexico to impose martial law on that area, to completely close off the roads, impose curfews. It is very, very bad. And a lot of that has to do with health, with socioeconomic disparities, and lack of running water, and there's a lot of factors that go into that. So in terms of contact tracing, can you bring up the question again so I can see the last part?
How are you or public health going to manage potential spread once lockdown lifts?
Yeah. So we're actually separated by a pretty decent mountain range from that county or from that area. So there actually isn't as much communication between northeastern Arizona and southeastern Arizona as you would think. Public health is definitely working on contract tracing for the regions that are heavily affected. And in our area, I mean, we don't know why we haven't had more cases, because many people who work in our area live in other counties or other states. Many, many people travel. And we just haven't had the cases that we would expect, but we are doing very aggressive contract tracing in town. The second case that we had was actually a family member of the first one, but we're doing as much as we can, and we will be continuing that once lockdown lifts more. Arizona opened up last week.
Thank you. And then we're shortly running out of time, so I just want to remind our viewers to reflect on what you've learned today and how it might change your practice. And while you do that and put your comments in the feed, I do want to ask one question to Dr. Clancy about Echo and if you've used Echo in your site.
Oh, absolutely. Echo is the project out of University of New Mexico that's grant funded free telementoring. And that is available for many, many different subspecialty fields. So for example, I've worked with the rheumatology echo for over 12 years, where I take rheumatology cases in my practice, present them to the rheumatologist, they give me the recommendations, and I take that back to the patient. But in during the COVID crisis, UNM has canceled all of its echo clinics and is focusing on COVID clinics only. And those are available for anyone across the US or the world. There are some with a New Mexico focus, but there are some with a US and an international focus. And if you go to echo.unm.edu, you can access all of those COVID lectures, which are not only on practical stuff like testing, but also on provider resiliency, trauma related care for people in on the front lines, just tons and tons of COVID related resources and peer counseling, peer recommendations.
Thank you. And Solomon Abdurrahman from Facebook asks, still, what is the best prevention that you realize is successful in your area?
I'm going to say the actions by the employers. And part of that is because we're such a unique community with the mine owning our large social gathering areas and shutting those down. But the employers have all been very supportive. They've moved social distancing and masking and hand sanitizing and telework into their businesses very rapidly. And so people, their employees, become aware of the gravity of the situation and the necessity for following these recommendations, not only at work, but at home. I think the mask drive has really raised awareness. And, you know, we've had tables outside of our one grocery store. Regularly, we're taking masks around to businesses. Our PA, who's heading it up, is very ferocious if she doesn't see someone wearing a mask. And she knows everybody in town. And so if she sees you not wearing a mask, she knows your name and where you work and when she gave you a mask and why aren't you wearing it? And so having those, a small town personal connection with people has also really made a difference in terms of keeping people's awareness of what needs to be done and those public health recommendations.
Well, thank you. So everybody is saying thank you for the presentation. And we do have some members commenting on what they'll do to change their practice, including establishing an outdoor tent. And with that reflection, we please join us for our next session, Managing the COVID-19 Crisis, What a Family Physician Needs to Know About Testing, with Dr. Kim Yu. And thank you for your talk.